In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. A very warm welcome this morning on the 8th Sunday after Trinity to St. Peter's Church in Matlusk. I'm delighted this morning that the Reverend Canon Roxanne Hunt will be preaching for us virtually. Roxanne is a priest in South London whom, as I said last week, she and I trained as curates together. It's not only the 8th Sunday after Trinity, it is Emancipation Sunday. And so we remember and recall not only all those who were forced into slavery, but those whose lives are still affected by slavery, those who still live in slavery. We know that still many people go unheeded and unheard and live in situations of abject poverty, controlled by others. And so we hold them in prayer before God, asking for God's grace and God's light as we as a community and as a society seek to respond in ways of justice, in ways of peace, in ways of love. I'm delighted too that we will have the gospel reading read for us by Andrew, that Chris and Diana will read our Genesis reading, where we hear of Jacob having a second dream, wrestling with God. And I'm grateful to Sarah for leading us in our intercessions. So as we come before God this morning, mindful not only of the great difficulties that we face in our lives, but mindful too of the great difficulties that so many others face, so many others who live in such difficulty. Let us hold a moment of silence. And so let us pray the collect for this, the 8th Sunday after Trinity. Almighty Lord and everlasting God, we beseech you to direct, sanctify, and govern both our hearts and bodies in the ways of your laws and the works of your commandments, that through your most mighty protection, both here and ever, we may be preserved in body and soul through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so the choir will sing for us shortly that wonderful hymn, "We Have a Gospel to Proclaim."
See you. The first reading relates Jacob's second famous dream. His first dream, which we heard a few weeks ago, occurred when he was sleeping at Bethel, and he dreamed of angels ascending and descending, and God said that he was with him. The second dream occurs after he has married. You'll recall from last week, Jacob now has two wives, Leah and Rachel. He comes to the ford of Jabbok, which may be identified today as the river Zarka near Amman in Jordan. He sends his wives across the river and settles down to sleep, and he has a very unsettling dream. The reading is taken from the 32nd chapter of Genesis, verse 22 to verse 31. The same night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was put out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said,
"Let me go, for the day is breaking."
But Jacob said,
"I will not let you go unless you bless me."
So he said to him,
"What is your name?"
And he said,
"Jacob."
Then the man said,
"You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans and have prevailed."
Then Jacob asked him,
"Please tell me your name."
But he said,
"Why is it that you ask my name?"
And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying,
"For I have seen God face to face, and yet my life is preserved."
The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. This is the word of the Lord.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said,
"This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves."
Jesus said to them,
"They need not go away. You give them something to eat."
They replied,
We have nothing here but five loaves and two fish.
And he said,
"Bring them here to me."
Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the five loaves and two fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds, and all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good morning, and thanks to Father David for inviting me to preach for you today. I bring you greetings from the United Benefice of Holy Innocents and St. Mark in South Norwood, in South London. It gives me great pleasure to be with you this morning. Emancipation Day, commemorated on the 1st of August, marks the day when the abolition of the Transatlantic Slave Trade Act of 1833 finally came into effect throughout most of the former British colonies in 1834, with the exception of modern-day Sri Lanka and St. Helens, where slavery was abolished 9 years later in 1843. Tomorrow, the first Monday in August, will be celebrated as a public holiday in most of the former British colonies, but especially those in the Caribbean. The festivities this year, of course, will be limited by the current COVID-19 pandemic. Not so here in London, though, where yesterday the Black Reformist Movement marched from Clapham Common to Windrush Square in Brixton on what is now called Reparations Day, a day to remind the British government that while not a penny was paid to the enslaved or their descendants, the slave owners were compensated for their loss of income from the human misery of those enslaved and brutalized. Recently, you may know that the University of Glasgow has taken the lead in announcing long overdue reparative justice measures. A regional alliance of Caribbean countries called on Britain's institutions to give back some of the wealth to the Caribbean by funding development at the epicenter of the slave trade. These callings will go on for a long time, and one hopes that the responses will be satisfactory to and for all concerned. On this Emancipation Day, I'm not sure the descendants of those slaves resident here in the UK feel particularly liberated to live as if they are really equally created in the image of God as other members of the human race. We only have to look at the news or read the news to realize how widespread is the police brutality against Black people, the racial discrimination in the workplace, in the housing market, in education, among the Windrush generation, and in our own Church of England, which Archbishop Justin describes as institutionally racist. Where is hope to be found? I suggest through the lens of today's gospel, which begins when Jesus heard about the events that led to the beheading of John the Baptist. Verse 13 says, he withdrew to a deserted place by himself. And just after our text for today, verse 23 reads, and after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. Like Jesus, we too are called to balance our public lives, our public personas, with times of withdrawal and solitude. We call to make time to attend to our emotions, our attitudes, our inner selves, paying attention to God's call and direction in the midst of the tumultuous events around us and within us. We are called to examine our action or inaction against the discrimination meted out against our Black sisters and brothers. We must understand that all lives matter is not the appropriate response to Black Lives Matter. If all lives really mattered, then there would be no need for a Black Lives Matter movement or the Church of England's Committee for Minority Ethnic Anglican Concerns. Statues are falling down, but what statues in your life needs pulling down? We are called to imitate Jesus by spending time alone in prayer so that we can be strengthened and equipped to do exactly what Jesus does in supporting the marginalized. I commend for your reading Ghost Ship by the Reverend Azariah France Williams, who explores the harrowing stories of institutional racism experienced within our own Church of England. And perhaps that will help you to realize what you can do as you examine yourselves in your quiet moments to bring about change as we all work to eradicate racial discrimination. I leave you with the lyrics from Bob Marley's redemption song. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We've got to fulfill the book. By the book, he means the Bible. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our prayers this morning are the same prayers that will be used at Mother Roxanne's church in South Norwood, the church in the United Benefice of Holy Innocents and St. Mark's. They are prayers appropriate for Emancipation Day. And this set of prayers, this litany, was written by the Reverend Dr. Yolanda Pierce of Princeton Theological Seminary in the US in the wake of the killing of Michael Brown in 2014. So let us pray for the church and for the world. Let us in our prayers thank God for his great goodness, and let us too in our prayers beseech that God will bring the liberation to all those who are enslaved, all those who are affected by slavery, all those who long for liberty.
I invite you to pray. Let us not rush to the language of healing before understanding the fullness of the injury and the depth of the wound. Let us not rush to offer a band-aid when the gaping wound requires surgery and complete reconstruction. Let us not offer false equivalencies, thereby diminishing the particular pain being felt in a particular circumstance, in a particular historical moment. Let us not speak of reconciliation without speaking of reparations and restoration, or how we can repair the breach and how we can restore the loss. Let us not rush past the loss of this mother's child, this father's child, someone's beloved son. Let us not value property over people. Let us not protect material objects while human lives hang in the balance. Let us not value a false peace over a righteous justice. Let us not be afraid to sit with the ugliness, the messiness, and the pain that is life in community together. Let us not offer clichés to the grieving, those whose hearts are being torn asunder. Instead, let us mourn black and brown men and women, those killed extrajudicially every 24 hours. Let us lament the loss of a teenager dead at the hands of a police officer who described him as a demon. Let us weep at a criminal justice system which is neither blind nor just. Let us call for the mourning men and the wailing women who's willing to rend their garments of privilege and ease and sit in the ashes of this nation's original sin. Let us be silent when we don't know what to say. Let us be humble and listen to the pain, rage, and grief pouring from the lips of our neighbours and friends. Let us decrease so that our brothers and sisters who live on the underside of history may increase. Let us pray with our eyes open and our feet firmly planted on the ground. Let us listen to the shattering glass and let us smell the purifying fires. For it is the language of the unheard. God, in your mercy, show me my own complicity in injustice. Convict me for my indifference. Forgive me when I have remained silent. Equip me with a zeal for righteousness. Never let me grow accustomed or acclimated to unrighteousness. Amen.
Let us pray with confidence in the words that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. As ever, I am so grateful for all those who make these services possible. For Sarah leading us in our prayers, for Andrew in reading the gospel, for Diana and Chris in leading that extraordinary scene of Jacob's dream. And I am most grateful to Roxanne for her words. It is a great shame that at the moment we can't invite Roxanne to be with us, and I know that she has so many duties in South London, but this extraordinary ability of these services means that we can literally place somebody into our virtual service. But I hope that we may one day be able to welcome her to the Mattless Benefice in person. So thank you very much indeed, Roxanne. Next week there will be no virtual service as we go to alternate weeks. We will have a real service at 10:30 in Saxthorpe. And so, as we prepare for the blessing, as we contemplate yet further the situation faced by so many, those who feel in such a dire circumstances, who feel marginalised and ignored, let us hold a moment of silence. And so the blessing.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep all of your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you, and all those whom you love and pray for, this day and always. Amen.